Quill Tree Books and Harper Audio present Champion of Fate by Kendare Blake, performed by Shayna Small. This book is dedicated to Mia Togul, one of my very first readers, and to my horse, Lassie, who both passed away in 2020. These ageless warriors and immortal horses are for you. 1. The Foundling. 1. The Settlement. The rice balls in the basket looked wrong. It didn't matter which way she stacked them, or how carefully she and Mama had rolled and re-rolled them into perfect shapes, stuffing each with sweetened paste made from the fruit that grew so plentifully around the new settlement. New fruit, tangy and soft, with a texture somewhere between bread and a root vegetable. Fruit that Reed had never seen before they came, not even in the large marketplace by the pier, where nearly anything could be found. "Enough fussing with those balls," Mama said. She had changed into her finest shift, soft linen dyed a dark crimson. "They will taste no better, and you're likely to dent them. Pick up the basket. Let's go." She sounded not cross, but distracted, like she was giving the order to herself rather than to Reed. Today, they went to see Orna, the wise woman, and Mama was no more excited about it than Reed was. "She won't even eat them if she knows I touched them," Reed said. And to make the point, she reached out a finger and touched one again. "That isn't true," Mama said. But she used her thumbs to wipe spots of dirt from her daughter's face and tugged her shoulders straight before they marched out of the lodge. Reed didn't like the new settlement. A new settlement for a new beginning, Papa said. But it was a jungle, hot and wild, the air too wet, and everything seemed to fight them. Branches snapped back and hit her in the nose. Long grasses tangled around her slim tan ankles to keep her from getting where she was going. Reed missed the port city where she'd grown up. Stone-paved roads and strong buildings, horses and ships and merchants who spoke many tongues. "Why does it matter if Orna likes me or not?" Reed asked as she and her mother walked. "She can't do anything to me." "It matters because it is unlucky, and because eventually it will make others... it will change the way others look at you." Mama paused and reached down to smooth Reed's long, dark hair. "Besides, she does like you. She was only irritable because of the seasickness and then the travel." Orna was on the last boat to arrive in the port from their home country. It was her arrival as much as their readiness that signaled it was time to depart for the settlement. Papa and Mama said she was a great mystic and a great healer who bent the ear of the gods. And she had hated little Reed the moment she set her old eyes on her. "Mater Orna," Mama said when they reached the door of the lodge. She used the honorary Mater to signify that they came to her as family. Had they come for healing or blessings, Mama would have called her Healer Orna or Wise Orna, as the case allowed. "Come in." They stepped through the door, which was not much of a door, but a flap made from woven reeds and plant fibers, the same fibers that comprised the basket that Reed held, and found Orna seated on the floor, on silk pillows and a thick wool rug. Reed had heard Mama whisper that the pillows wouldn't last long in the heat and wetness before they started to grow mold. Killy, the oldest daughter of the family, who shared space with the wise woman, came forward to greet them from where she sat in the far corner, tending three toddlers. But when Orna saw them, she simply said, "Oh, it's you. And went back to playing a solitary game with colored stones that Reed didn't know how to play. Mama nudged her, and Reed stepped forward to offer the basket of rice balls.
For you, Mater Orna, Reed said, and lowered her head.
She and Mama waited in the silence. Long silence. Until Mama lost her temper.
You don't really mean to ignore her when she is right in front of you.
When who is right in front of me?
Orna asked. Mama's lips drew into a thin, grim line, an expression that Reed knew well, but Orna didn't seem afraid, despite Mama's great height and her strong arms, muscled from pulling fish from the sea and the river. The men of their people worked the earth. Papa knew how to make brick from mud and clay, how to sow seed and build lodges, but one day Reed would work the water, like her mother, strong enough to wade into the current and pull up the traps of crab and crayfish, strong enough to battle the fish who bit their lines, even the flat ones who hugged the silt and sand at the bottom.
Reed is a good girl and a hard worker. I don't care who you are. I won't let you treat her like she is cursed.
Reed's chest warmed as Mama pulled her to her waist. No one was as fierce as Mama was. Not Papa, not Auntie Lyra, and certainly not mean Orna, who sat on legs like thin sticks and had cheeks like empty cloth.
I never said she was cursed, Orna said. Nor did I say she was bad. I only said she was not ours.
At last, she looked at Reed, and Reed wished she hadn't. The emptiness in that look made her feel even more invisible than before.
Not ours, Orna said again. Not mine, and not yours, plain for anyone to see. So why get attached?
Orna, Mama said, and tried once more. Wise Orna, what does that mean?
Orna's eyes dropped to the basket of rice balls, and for a moment Reed thought they had won, that she would take them, and the unpleasant errand would be over.
Take those out of here, Orna said, and let the girl have them. Give her something sweet. I do not think she will be with us for much longer.
What does that old hag know?
Mama was irate as they walked through the settlement, past other lodges and the communal hearth, past the site of the future church, now just a square of large, smooth stones.
Mama,
Reed said, and tugged on her shift. They were passing the enclosure where they kept the goats and sheep and the many donkeys who had helped them carry their belongings through the wet, wooded country. Reed would have liked to stop and feed them a few rice balls, but Mama brushed her hand away and stalked on. She didn't stop until they reached their lodge and burst through the flap so quickly that it swung back and hit Reed in the face.
Wise Orna.
Mama sneered to herself as she tore out of her good crimson dress and pulled on a white work dress, yellowed with water stains.
More like foolish Orna, wicked Orna.
She wrapped her dark hair in brown fabric and secured it with a rough length of cord. Mama looked at Reed, and Reed heard Orna's words.
She is not ours, not mine, not yours.
What a lot of nonsense.
Reed peered into the basket of rice balls, and Mama's foul mood eased. She cracked a rueful smile and laughed, which made Reed laugh too.
Go ahead, she said.
She reached in for a rice ball and took a big bite.
We can have a treat before going to the river.
We deserve it, I'd say.
Reed took two rice balls before going to change out of her good shift. By the river, they dressed for the heat, with dark fabric over their shoulders to protect from the sun and white linens for easy wading into the shallows. River work should have been cooling, but
but where the water stagnated in the bend, it was sometimes as warm as a bath. She walked with Mama out of the settlement to the river, eating a rice ball in tiny bites to make it last. She tucked the other one into a pouch around her neck, too high for the water to reach. She thought about offering it to Mama, but instead she decided to save it for Gray Anders, her favorite donkey. That night, Reed lay by herself, tired after hours in the sun and mud, stretched out in the shadows while the rest of the lodge talked, gathered families trading the stories of the day. Papa sat on the only chair with two of the smaller children on his knees. He had his shirt off and laid across his lap. Mama snatched it from him and flicked him with it. "Dress before dinner," she said, smiling. "You're starting to look like an Aurelian."
"And so I am,"
he said. But he took the shirt back and pulled it over his head.
"So are we all, now that Aurelia is our home. In this new place, we can leave our old things behind. No more leathers and woven cloaks. No more armor."
He placed the children on the floor and stood to take Mama's face in his hands.
"Or your jeweled pins. This place demands new ways."
"And what about what we were? Does that have no value?"
Mama didn't often speak of their lives before the port, but Reed had heard her say that in their home country, Papa was a rich man and a great soldier. Stories like that made Reed wonder why they ever left. But Papa spoke of the settlement as a great adventure. Reed didn't see the adventure in biting flies and digging for clams. She didn't feel it in the hard ground under her sleeping mat. But she loved her father. Everything would be fine, as long as he and Mama said it would be. And Reed let her eyes drift shut. The raiders came while the fires burned low, and bowls from evening meals still rested in drowsy laps. They wove themselves into the settlement on silent feet, first one, then two, then many more, armed with short swords and spears and sharp knives strapped to their belts. They looped through the families in loose coils, like a lazy noose tossed around the head of an unwitting animal. And then they pulled it taut. Reed was asleep when the attack began, her head resting on her arm, thrown up toward the cooking fire as if waiting for someone to place a bowl of stew in her hand. She didn't see her parents' faces freeze when the raiders stepped into the light, their cheeks marked with a blue paste. She didn't see her father stand and hold out his hands, nor hear him say, "We have nothing." So she didn't see the raiders swing his sword and cut him down. It was her mother's scream that finally ripped her from sleep. And in the end, it was also what saved her. Mama charged their attacker and held his arms high, pushing him through the lodge like an ox. She meant to shove him right out through the door flap, but instead he pivoted and they slammed into the lodge wall, which had been built for peace from long sticks, plant fibers, and dried clay. The entire side of the lodge came down, right onto Reed, and she pulled her knees up tight as it knocked the breath from her lungs. Scrambling, she clawed at the ground, afraid she would be trampled and crushed into the dirt. All through the settlement came screams and wails and the sounds of running, stomping feet. The air smelled of smoke.
"Mama!"
Reed pushed herself toward what she hoped was the way out. Rough bark and sharp grasses cut into her shoulders and legs. She had to help Mama. She would fight, and then they would run and hide by the river in the tall grass. When the sun came up, they would find Papa and the others. She pushed forward toward an orange-red glow, more light than the cook fire usually gave off. "The lodge is burning," she thought. And then her mother's body hit the ground in front of her. Mama lay on the dirt floor, head rolling from side to side as blood ran from her chest to pool in the hollows of her collarbone. Reed froze.
Mama!
Mama looked at her. She saw her, huddled in the wreckage.
Stay,
she mouthed.
I can't,
Reed whispered. But she did as she was told. She remained still and quiet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.